We're going to talk a little bit about people in correctional facilities.
Mm-hmm.
I was amazed when I first got into the field of hepatitis to learn that an estimated 1 in 3 people with chronic hepatitis C has been through a jail or a prison. It made me want to go work in jails and prisons because I'm dedicated to this work. It made me realize that that was one of the places where public health, healthcare mm-hmm. providers, and others needed to focus efforts because there's such great need among people who are incarcerated.
And actually, years and years ago, and I can't even tell you how many years ago it was now, I was part of a study called Project START that did HIV and viral hepatitis and STD prevention for young men being released from prison. And as part of that experience, one of the things I really took away from it was that this idea that people who are in prison are somehow walled off from our communities and they're just put away, gone forever, just how false that was. And I think when we think about people who are incarcerated, we have to really think of them as people who are community members, parents, uncles, aunts, sons
children.
And daughters, friends. They're a part of our community, and almost all of them are going to return to the community at some point in time, often after not too much time.
Yeah.
And so we can't forget about them. And the health of people who are incarcerated is a part of community health as well.
Thank you. Absolutely. So with us here today is Matthew Akiyama, assistant professor of medicine and attending physician, primarily at Montefiore Medical Center, but he's here to share today about his work in jail on hepatitis C. Matthew?
Thanks, Corinna. Hi, everyone. As Corinna mentioned, my name is Matthew Akiyama. I'm an assistant professor of medicine at Montefiore and Albert Einstein College of Medicine. And really want to thank the organizers for the invitation and opportunity to speak on this important topic and the patients who have spoken thus far, Knut, Earl, and Kaylin as well. It's been really incredible to hear your stories. So Hep C and incarceration, as Corinna was mentioning, enriched well. It's a large topic to cover in 5 minutes, but I'll try to take on some of the more major challenges and highlight some of the key issues. And I'll close with some voices from patients in the criminal justice system who we would love to have joined us today. I'm going to focus on hepatitis C since this is the area I have more experience with in the correctional setting, but many of the same concepts apply to hepatitis B as well. As I'm sure everyone on the webinar is aware, due to policies of mass incarceration in the last 4 decades, there has been a large rise in individuals with substance use disorders in the criminal justice system. And due to the interrelationship with substance use disorders, hepatitis C prevalence estimates range from 10 to 40%, depending on the setting. This represents what Meryl Singer, an anthropologist at University of Connecticut, described as syndemic of hepatitis C and substance use disorders, as well as HIV and other communicable illnesses, and I would argue incarceration as well. I think it makes sense to frame the issues in terms of the care cascade within the continuum of the community and criminal justice system for patients living with hepatitis C. So the first step in the care continuum is testing. And for the last several years, national guidelines have recommended testing for individuals with criminal justice association. The Federal Bureau of Prisons followed suit in October of last year and also made the recommendation for universal opt-out screening in their guidelines. But uptake has lagged in these recommendations and challenges still remain, in part because of cost and personnel, as well as personnel for pre and post-test counseling. And all of these steps involved with testing, particularly components involving follow-up, require work and collaboration with the Department of Corrections to ensure patients are able to come to clinic to receive their test results and post-test counseling. For the sake of time, I won't discuss confirmatory testing, but needless to say, this is something that needs to occur for patients to be aware of their chronic infection and adds a time delay of several days at minimum and more often weeks to months before counseling can be done for a patient to confirm their diagnosis. This is particularly challenging in the jail setting where lengths of stay are often do not permit communication of test results. And until one-step testing options are available, this will remain a challenge. So moving on to treatment in the cascade, we need to think of treatment broadly in terms of treatment in correctional settings versus linkage to an engagement in care in the community, though in reality, there's often overlap in terms of patients coming into the correctional setting on treatment and vice versa. As for treatment in the correctional setting, cost is clearly a key barrier. Part of the challenge is that costs are dependent on state budgets, and while payment structures are too complicated to discuss in detail here, the majority of patients in the correctional setting are going untreated currently. This is being overcome in certain settings with creative pricing and payment structures. Also, there is now even newer generation of therapies available, which might help drive down costs and hopefully expand access to treatment. While cost is clearly a major factor here, we need to also be thinking about issues like workforce capacity expansion, telementoring, and other models of care to expand delivery in correctional settings. If treatment can't be accomplished in corrections, linkage to care for treatment in the community is essential. but there are many barriers for former detainees following reentry, and these range from financial, including poverty, to reactivation of their health insurance following reentry, distrust of the medical system, readiness for treatment, ongoing or relapsed active substance use disorders, among others. Some of these barriers can be mitigated by working in collaboration with community-based organizations to maximize engagement in care on reentry into the community, as well as treatment of active substance use disorders, both in corrections and in the transition to the community. Interventions at the governmental level also show promise. For example, the New York State Department of Health began finalizing a waiver in April of 2016 with CMS, in which a request was made to enable the state to use Medicaid funding to pay for coordination and services 30 days prior to release. So common themes that emerge are partnering with CBOs, but also with DOC and lobbying for policy changes in order to ensure the care cascade is as seamless as possible in the transition from the community to the correctional setting and back again. And to finish off, I wanted to bring in some voices of individuals with hepatitis C in the New York City jail system. One 40-year-old gentleman said, "When I hit the street and have my freedom again, I want to have that part of my life done with," referring to jail, drug use, and his hep C infection. "This is a young man's game. I plan on changing my whole life around. I might even relocate." Another woman said, "I'm on a new road. I'm not interested in going backward." These are some of the voices of individuals who are ready to be treated but still have difficulty accessing treatment in the correctional system. As previously stated, many have difficulty with linkage to and engagement in treatment upon reentry into the community, making this a priority population for additional intervention. And with that, I'll pass it on to the next speaker.
Thank you, Matthew. Really great to hear about the good work going on in New York. I believe that there are other departments of correction that are working on hepatitis B and hepatitis C. And I hope that we can continue to highlight those, you know, beyond today and into future with our work here.
Yeah, no, because I mean, part of our job is not only to like call attention to the problems and the challenges, but really to kind of shine a light on the successful programs and activities that are out there. And so we love hearing when people are doing good work and making a difference. So let us know. And I kind of just wanted to add real quickly, Karina, we didn't talk about this, but I'm going to kind of take director's prerogative.
Go for it.
I want to encourage people, if there are any comments or suggestions that you want to give to us about future webinars, things you're interested in, things you want to hear more about, or any feedback you want to provide to us, you can go ahead and use the chat function, type in any notes to us there, and all that gets saved, and we'll be able to print it out and read it after the webinar.